Good morning, everyone. What a delight to see all of you here this morning. What an honor it is to be able to come together in the presence of Almighty God. Think about that. The Lord is here with us, and we are honored to be in His holy presence. I want to welcome all of you who are with us this morning, both here at West Olive, and also all of you that are watching at home on our live stream. It is a joy to be with you, and I know that those of you who are not with us in the flesh are with us in spirit, and we will all be worshiping God together. And that, of course, is what it's all about. Amen. Our shepherds are leading us through a process of getting things back to normal. This week, our Wednesday night class resumes, just the auditorium class. And if you can remember way back the last time that Wednesday night class met, we were studying the book of Hebrews. So we're going to continue in our book of Hebrews. And this Wednesday, what we'll do, we've studied already the first five chapters. That's what we've gotten covered. And so we will be doing a review of chapter 1, 2, 3, 4, and 5. Hit the high spots, see what you can remember, and then move on into chapter 6. Then next Sunday morning, a week from today, and all of this is in your bulletin, it's online, but just to kind of review and bring us up to date. Next Sunday, we'll have the evening service resume. And so we're looking forward to that. And then on the 21st of the month, then our morning, Sunday morning auditorium class will begin here. In fact, it's all classes, isn't it, Steve? Yes. All classes will begin on the 21st of this month. We just pray God's blessings, that God will be honored, that God will continue to protect us, that He'll continue to lead us through this very turbulent time. And, you know, folks sometimes going through things like are going on in our country right now just make us hungry for home, doesn't it? From Psalm 116, verses 1 and 2. I love the Lord because He hears my voice and my supplications, because He has inclined His ear to me. Therefore, I shall call on Him as long as I live. Let's pray. Father, we are truly honored to be in Your holy presence today. Thank You, Father, for being here with us. May all that we say and do be an honor and glory to Your majestic and mighty name. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Steve?
Good morning, all. I share Ray's sentiment. I'm so glad to see you all here this morning. And for those of you tuned in on the live stream, welcome. We're going to sing two songs as the screen shows before we have a prayer. How great Thou art.
O Lord my God, my soul, my Savior,
We indeed acknowledge your goodness and your mercy and your grace to us. We acknowledge that you are the God who hears us when we pray to you, the God that is merciful, the God that is kind. Your mercy and your compassion is evident by the fact that you sent your Son to die for us. You sent your Son to be that atoning sacrifice for us. And it is at this time that we acknowledge that you are the great God who saves. You're the loving God, the merciful God, the kind and giving God. You are our Father, and we are your children. Father, we thank you so much for your mercy and kindness at times like these. It is in the midst of turmoil that we can come to you. In the midst when things seem to be chaotic, we can come to you and find peace. We can find words of comfort from you. As we delve into your word, we find that you are still God on the throne. You give us the victory. You've given us the victory. You've given us hope. You encourage us from day to day, from faith to faith. We acknowledge that you are our God and we are your people. Father, let us continue to find our hope in you. Let us continue to seek you out, to serve you without fear, respecting who you are. Lord God, we thank you so much for times like these, where we acknowledge that we need one another, that we need one another as brothers and sisters, that it's times like these that we look to you for guidance and comfort. We thank you so much for the leaders here, for the shepherds, for the ministers. We thank you so much for the servants of you who send out encouraging words of comfort, who send out encouraging words and messages that ascribe honor to you and to give us hope. Father, we thank you for this gathering, both here and online. We thank you so much for the comfort you give and that you will give. Father, continue to bless us in this gathering. For it's in the name of Jesus we pray. Amen. Amen.
Our next song will be number 669. This is My Father's World. The earth is the Lord's in all its fullness. The world and those who dwell therein. Psalm 24:1. Let's sing.
This is my Father's. Oh.
587. I'm going to do that as well. 587, soul, a savior, thou art needing. For those who are in the assembly, we will be raising the screen after the scripture reading. So you'll want to have number 587 marked in your hymn book. Now, if you want to use the hymn book, we're going to sing 531, as the screen says. I'm requesting that all were able to stand. As we sing Praise the Lord, it's hard to sing this song while seated. I remain standing for the reading of the scripture.
Praise the Lord, ye heavens.
Scripture reading today will be Acts the 17th chapter, verses 22 through 28. I'll be reading from the New American Standard Bible. So Paul stood in the midst of the Areopagus and said, "Men of Athens, I observe that you are very religious in all respects. For while I was passing through and examining the objects of your worship, I found an altar with this inscription, to an unknown God. Therefore, what you worship in ignorance, this I proclaim to you. The God who made the world and all things in it, since he is Lord of heaven and earth, does not dwell in temples made with hands, nor is he served by human hands, as though he needed anything, since he himself gives to all people life and breath and all things. And he made from one man every nation of mankind to live on all the face of the earth, having determined their appointed times and boundaries of their inhabitations, that they would seek God, if perhaps they might grope for him and find him, though he is not far from each one of us. For in him we live and move and exist. And as some of your own poets have said, for we also are his children.
Almost a century ago, in fact, now more than a century ago, an old man was traveling alone by train through France. A much younger man who was sitting next to him watched as the older man reached into his traveling case and pulled out a Bible and began to read it. After a while, the younger man decided to strike up a conversation with him, and he said, "What are you reading, sir?" The reply was, "I'm reading from the 6th chapter of the Gospel according to Mark in the New Testament." "What does it say?" the young man asked him. "It's the story about the miracle of Jesus performing through the loaves and the fishes. The Gospel writer tells us about a vast crowd that had followed Jesus. Jesus preached to them until it was dark, and then he multiplied a very small lunch to feed that entire crowd of 5,000 people. And when the people had finished eating, there were 12 baskets of leftovers." A little scornful, the young man said, "Do you really believe that?" "Yes, I do," came the reply of the older man, to which the younger man answered, "I can see that you've been brainwashed by ancient superstitions. That could never happen to me. You see, I am a scientist. And because I am a scientist, everything happens in this world can ultimately be accounted for scientifically. The story that you have just described defies the laws of science and therefore is sheer fantasy. Give me facts, provable, probable facts. As a man of science, I can have no faith in miracles. But I cannot expect you to understand that." At this point, the train began to slow down. "Here is my station," said the young man as he rose from his seat. "It was nice talking to you, Mr. I'm sorry I didn't get your name." Whereupon the old man handed him his calling card. The old man with the unscientific mind, the old man who had been brainwashed by ancient superstitions, the old man who could not be expected to comprehend the complexities of science, the old man's card bore his name, Louis Pasteur, perhaps one of the greatest of all scientists. That spirit is not new. Paul writes about that same spirit in 1 Corinthians chapter 1. "For the word of the cross is foolishness to those who are perishing, but to those of us who are being saved, it is the power of God. For it is written, I will destroy the wisdom of the wise, and the cleverness of the clever I will set aside. Where is the wise man? Where is the scribe? Where is the debater of this age? Has not God made foolish the wisdom of the world? For since in the wisdom of God, the world through its wisdom did not come to know God, God was well pleased through the foolishness of the message preached to save those who believe. For indeed, Jews ask for signs and Greeks seek for wisdom. But we preach Christ crucified, to the Jews a stumbling block, and to the Gentiles foolishness. But to those who are called, both Jews and Greeks, Christ the power of God and the wisdom of God." Doubters' common cry against believing in God is that the existence of God cannot be proven. It's not reasonable to believe in a creator who created the universe, so they say. Remember many years ago, and it's been many years ago, I was a senior in Cooley High in Detroit, Michigan. I needed a science class, so physiography sounded interesting to me, the study of the Earth's surface, and I enjoyed the class immensely. My teacher was Miss Cravens. I remember her distinctly, because in one particular class, and I don't recall what the study was or what the conversation was, But I remember she began to make some rather derogatory marks regarding the Bible as being old-fashioned and so on and so forth. Now, in my class and several other classes which I had was your typical Fonzie. This was back in the 50s. He had the most gorgeous ducktail head of hair you've ever seen, and I never saw him without a black leather jacket. But he cleared his throat, and he said, "Miss Cravens, have you ever read the Bible?" It was silent for a moment, and then the class picked up on another subject. Faith deserves investigation. Faith has nothing to fear from honest investigation. Is it really reasonable to believe in the existence of God? That's where we're going this morning, and the next several weeks it is my plan to have lessons somewhat similar to this, at least dealing with God. Who is God, etc., as we go on through the next number of Sunday mornings. Is it reasonable to believe in God? Well, that depends on what you mean by the word reasonable. If by reasonable you mean that we accept that, like the young scientist on the train with Louis Pasteur, that which is reasonable is only that which can be accepted by human reason alone, then perhaps it's not reasonable from that point of view to believe in God. As the young man said, he wanted facts, he wanted scientific realities, he wanted something that was logical, he wanted something that could be proven in the laboratory. In other words, that if you can't see something, then it apparently doesn't exist. If you can't touch it, then it isn't evidently real, or at least so seemed to be his theory, and the theory of many even living today. Many years ago, the Russian cosmonaut, I can't remember his name, but he was circling the Earth, and I remember he sent back a rather laughable report one day saying that he'd been circling the Earth now for a number of days, and I've never seen God, he said. Well, of course, that means God doesn't exist. Because, you see, if God existed, surely he would have seen him. Or at least so he thought. If you can't see God, then apparently God doesn't exist. So if this is what we mean by reasonable, faith in God will never be reasonable to many people. But do we mean faith in God, which is based on human reason plus faith? Then, of course, we're on a different page entirely. President Abraham Lincoln once said, "Accept all of the Bible that you can by reason, and then accept the rest of it by faith, and you will live and die a better person." Ever stop and think about how much you and I accept by faith? For example, Mr. Lincoln. I never saw him. I've never talked to anybody that ever saw him. But I believe that he lived, because there's evidence to prove that he believed. The pictures that we see, the historical accounts that we see, all of these things are evidences, though you and I have never seen him. Yet we know that he lived because of the evidence, and so it is with God. In fact, we accept all history in this way, by faith. We weren't there when a number of things happened in the history of humanity, yet we believe that they did in fact happen because of the evidence supporting the fact that they believe that it did happen. Christianity is a system of faith. Paul said, "We walk by faith and not by sight." So as Lincoln says, take what you can by reason, if it makes sense and you can see evidence and so forth of it, then fine, but accept the rest of it by faith simply because you believe and you believe in God, then that would be better. But don't forget this. Atheism is a system of faith. Scientificism is a system of faith. Believing in evolution is a system of faith. And don't let anyone tell you otherwise. No one was ever back in the beginning to know how it actually started 80 quadrillion years ago, or however long the latest estimation is. No one was there to know how it all began. And so it's a system of faith. Some believe one, some believe another. There are those who say, as perhaps the cosmonaut might have said, you can't prove that there is a God. The reply is, you can't possibly prove that there is no God. You can come an awful lot closer to proving that God does exist than someone could come to proving that God does not exist. There is much, much evidence that God exists. But how would you go about proving that God does not exist? It can't, of course, be done. Human reason by itself, of course, is fallible and faulty. Even within not that many generations ago from our existence, the earth being round was at one time, centuries ago, thought to be totally unreasonable. Ridiculous. We know that the earth is flat, like a tabletop. How else could it be? Even though the Bible talks about the fact that God sits on the circle of the earth, and there's other evidences of the roundness of it, if you will. But that was thought to be absurd. In the lifetime of some of us, many of the things that we see, air flight was once thought to be unreasonable, not in our time, but before our time. The very fact that a human being could make a device of some kind whereby he could fly through the air like a bird was an unreasonable thing. If you had told my grandfather in his younger days that someday, not quite in his lifetime, but only just a couple of years after he would die, people would be walking on the moon, he would have thought you were crazy. But there it is. That's become kind of old hat now, although I think we're talking about going and doing it again. Mars, yes, that's a step farther. The fact is that every error that has ever been made teaches us plainly that human reason in and of itself and by itself is frequently faulty and frequently foolish. Every mistake that we made is indication that we're not the perfect ones, those who know everything, etc. Well, let's look at the positive side of this. Belief in God is reasonable based on the evidence that God exists. And that's where you and I need to think carefully, because there is so much evidence of the existence of God. This morning, I want us to just think briefly of four specific things that give evidence that there is a God, that God does exist. Consider, first of all, the miracle of this book, the Bible. You have one with you. You have one perhaps in your hand. You have one in the pew before you. You probably have several at home. Have you ever really thought about the miracle of the existence of this book? The construction of this book. 66 different books, some call it a library of 66 different books, and yet all blending together as though one person had sat down for a few months and had composed it from beginning to end. But stop and think that one person did not sit down and begin to compose it from beginning to end, but in fact, over the years, approximately 40 different individuals, in some cases speaking different languages, living in different cultures, they wrote their portion of the Word of God by the inspiration of the Holy Spirit, and that just fits in its place like a hand fits in a glove. And that process, from the time that the first writer, Moses, took a pen, of a writing instrument of some kind, and began to write, in the beginning. And the time that the Apostle John laid down his pen and wrote, Amen. 1,500 years had gone by. Now, I thought about that, and okay, 1,500 years. Well, when you start talking about millions of years and billions of years, that doesn't seem like such a big deal. But think about it this way. Go back to the year 520 AD. I don't really remember much of what was going on in 520 AD. But just think about the world as it was, as best you can from your study of history and so on. And just suppose that in 520 AD, someone started to write a book. And then 100 years, 200 years, somebody else wrote a book. Another 100 years, somebody else wrote a book. Another 100 years, somebody else wrote a book. 50 years, somebody else wrote a book. And today, the last word will be written. A book that started in 520 AD, finished today. That's the picture that we have with the Bible. 1,500 years from the time the first words were written till the time the last years were written. When you think about it along those lines, I think it makes a little more sense, at least to me. But not only is it just the sense of the book itself, but it's also its record, for example, of fulfilled prophecies. We know the Old Testament was completed some 400 years before the New Testament was written. And yet the Old Testament is replete with prophetic statements, many of which were fulfilled during the first century. Many are yet to be fulfilled. Just the record of those predictions and prophecies and so forth that we find in the scriptures really cannot be explained just by human reason. The fact is, when you look at the Bible, it's not 40 different writers. It's one author with others who he inspires to write from his mind, his thoughts, his words, and they were the words that were recorded over all those years. Secondly, think for a moment about the moral law in the heart of man. The fact that whether we do right or not at times, basically innately within the human race, is a feeling of right or wrong. That something is okay to do or something isn't okay to do. We have a conscience within us, innately, born within us. Now, Paul talks about some who have had their consciences seared with a hot iron. You can destroy that conscience, but still that conscience was put there by God. It shows us more than mere animal development. We're not just a better monkey, for example, but that God created us in his own image and put a very part of himself inside each one of us. We call it the moral law. Thirdly, think about the eternal nature of something. I talked about going back to the very beginning, and no mortal was there to say, oh yes, I remember when that happened. That's exactly how it happened. I remember a quotation from my college days. It said this, something is. We can see that. We're in a building. Here's a pulpit. Something is. Therefore, something eternally was. For from nothing, nothing comes. If you could ever go back to the time, theoretically only, where there was nothing, nothing existed, then nothing could ever exist. From nothing, nothing comes. The question is, what is the first source, the first cause? Is it mind? Or is it matter? Is it God? Or is it rocks? The eternal nature of something. The Bible teaches that God is the first cause, that God has always existed, that there never was a time when God did not exist. He was in the beginning, and he created all things. The fourth evidence for this morning's lesson is the obvious design in the universe. Think about it for a moment, and if anything proves the existence of God, it occurs to me that that would be what it is, the existence of a designer. Someone says you cannot have design without a designer. You can't have thought without a thinker. Paul in the Roman letter speaks somewhat to that in chapter 1, verses 19 and 20, specifically several verses in that area, where he's showing the folly of not believing in God, the foolishness of believing that there is no God. But these two verses, 19 and 20, he says of those people, because that which is known about God is evident within them, for God made it evident to them. For since the creation of the world, his invisible attributes, his eternal power and divine nature have been clearly seen, being understood through that which was made, so that they are without excuse. Paul said all you have to do is look at the universe around you and realize the existence of God. We know today that computers and cameras don't just happen. Somebody had to design them. Somebody had to make them, etc. No one, I suppose, would ever dispute that. But think about the complexities of the universe in which we live and imagine nobody designed it. Nobody had any plans. Somehow there was this huge explosion. I'm not sure what exploded, but there was this huge explosion, and all of a sudden it all began. Life is far more complex than that. In the Natural History magazine, this comment was made, and this goes back a ways. The nervous system of a single starfish. Think about that for a minute. The nervous system of a single starfish is more complex than London, England's telephone exchange. Now, that was written 40 or 50 years ago, probably. But it does give you some idea, the amazing complexity of little things. I saw a bug outside on the patio the other day. I could barely see him. He was so tiny. I mean, he was tiny, tiny. And yet I stopped to think, that little fellow has muscles. He's able to eat. He's able to get rid of that which he's eaten. He can see. He knows to go here or there. He can recognize whatever food it is he eats. All of that in a creature so small you could barely see him with the human eye. Rather amazing. The whole universe is a balanced unit. It is run by unswerving laws. The more we know about the movement of the planets and the stars, the more astounded we are. The fact that you could go back, scientists can go back today 1,000 years and tell you whether it was a full moon on that day or a partial moon. And they can look forward 1,000 years and tell you something that's going to happen in terms of the movement of the stars, because it's all so complex, it's all so complete, it works so perfectly, there's so very little variation. It didn't just happen. It is reasonable to believe in God. Albert Einstein, the famous scientist himself, talked about that law that you can see, that everything is moving in perfect harmony in the universe. He said the scientist's religious feeling takes the form of a rapturous amazement at the harmony of natural law. This is a scientist saying this, which reveals an intelligence of such superiority that, compared with it, all the systematic thinking and acting of human beings is an utterly insignificant reflection. It's pretty powerful, particularly considering who said it. We go back to the book of Psalms, and we're reminded, as in Psalm 19, verse 1, the heavens are telling the glory of God, and the expanse is declaring the work of his hand, which is precisely what Paul was talking about in Romans chapter 1. Or we go to Psalm chapter 8. O Lord, our Lord, how majestic is your name in all the earth, who have displayed your splendor above the heavens. From the mouths of infants and nursing babes you have established strength because of your adversaries, to make the enemy and the revengeful cease. When I consider your heavens, the work of your fingers, the moon and the stars which you have ordained. What is man that you take thought of him, and the son of man that you care for him? Good question. It is reasonable to believe in God. Let me give you another quote from the 60s to conclude. Someone made a parody of all of this, of the human scientific thinking, like the young man on the train with Louis Pasteur. In the beginning, there was man, thinking, laughing, smoking, stronger than dirt. He decided that it was he who created the heavens and the earth and the hosts therein. And man said, "Let there be light." And there was. Neon lights, fluorescent lights, flashing lights, spotlights, laser lights, mercury vapor light, General Electric, Sylvania, Westinghouse, all blinking on and off at the will of man. And man saw the abundant light and said to the host assembled, "Live better electrically." And man called the light Edison, and he called the darkness power outage. And man said, "Let the earth bring forth green things." And it was so, for man tilled the ground and seeded the clouds, and man beheld the great bumper crops which he had made. And he said, "Yo ho ho, I am the jolly green giant." And it was good. And man split the atom, assembled computers, and conquered the heavens, space, and the earth he called ground control. But man gazed into his space, saying, "Let there be voices to sing my praises." And it was so, for there came Telstar, Early Bird, and Lunar Orbiter. And man heard the voices which he had made and nodded, A-OK. Then man said, "Let us make God in our own image, after our likeness, and let him have dominion over an hour on Sunday." And it was so. God was quite like a doting father, and definitely on our side. And man congratulated himself for his success and his wisdom in all things. In fact, he drank a toast from his thermos, put God on a shelf, returned to his own ways, and blew himself up. And in the end, there was God, and his sighing was too deep for words. God stepped out of nowhere, stood on nothing, said the word, and created everything. It is reasonable to believe in God. I hope you believe in God with all your heart and soul. I hope these songs that Steve has led us in this morning about how great our God is and so forth, how good our God is, that has really touched your heart, and that the thoughts together along with those songs has helped to confirm in your own mind the existence of God. Now, because God exists and because he is your creator, he loves you, and he wants you to be with him. He wants you to be part of his family. He's given us a way by the sending of his own begotten son to die on the cross, that you and I might have that hope of one day being with him in the place that Jesus has gone to prepare for us now. And so this morning, if you are subject to the invitation, if you've never become a New Testament Christian by obeying the gospel, let us know how we can help as we stand and sing.
chose this song because it begins with the words, God sent his son. So let's sing this. We're only going to sing the first verse.
God sent his son.
Brothers and sisters, we have this wonderful opportunity to assemble, to remember our Savior and the life that was paid, that we can have remission of sins. We read about this Lord's Supper in Matthew and Mark and Luke. And in 1 Corinthians, we can read about the death, the burial, and the resurrection of our Savior in Matthew 27, Mark 15, Luke 23, and John 19. Paul has something to say to the Roman Christians, renewing their mind in this. Speaking specifically about the resurrection of our Savior and also about our resurrection as we came up out of the watery grave of baptism. I'll begin with chapter 6 and verse 1. What shall we say then? Shall we continue in sin that grace may abound? Certainly not. How shall we, who died to sin, live any longer in it? Or do you not know that as many of us as were baptized into Christ Jesus were baptized into his death? Therefore, we were buried with him through baptism into death, that just as Christ was raised from the dead by the glory of the Father, even so we also should walk in newness of life. For if we have been united together in the likeness of his death, certainly we also shall be in the likeness of his resurrection. Knowing this, that our old man was crucified with him, that the body of sin might be done away with, that we should no longer be slaves of sin. This is our resurrection, brothers and sisters. When we came up out of that water, we were just as pure as our Savior because his blood had cleansed us from all sin. And yes, it was through our obedience and still is. Would you pray with me? Holy Father, as we partake of this bread in remembrance of that body of Jesus, we pray that you would be with each of us. Help us, Father, to examine our own resurrection and our own life as we partake of this. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. As Jesus was there hanging on that cross, let us visualize the blood that was shed that we can be washed clean of our every sin. And it happened at that particular moment of our resurrection when we came up out of the grave of baptism. Would you pray with me? Holy Father, we thank you so much for this opportunity to partake of this fruit of the vine in remembrance of the death, the burial, and the resurrection of our Savior. Help us, Father, as we do this, that we examine our own selves, that we continue to abide in your word. In Christ's name we pray. Amen. As we are assembled, it is a excellent time for us to return to God what he is letting us use. There was an elderly widow that Jesus tells us about. When all of these prominent people were giving a small portion of what they had, this widow, in turn, was very poor, and she gave everything that she had, even though it was just a little bit. When I think about that, I'm almost ashamed of myself. The Apostle Paul tells us how to give. In his letter to the Corinthian church, in 2 Corinthians chapter 8, about the first five verses of that chapter, Paul tells these Corinthians about the Macedonian churches and what they had given. Out of their poverty, they had given. They gave, from what the scripture says, more than they were able. I don't know how you do that, because apparently I have never done it. Let's think about these things as we give. And all of the good work, all of the souls that can be saved because of what we give. Pray with me, church. Father, we thank you for this marvelous opportunity that we have to lay by in store, to give, Father, so that others might be saved. Forgive us when we fail you. Help us always to continue in your word. In Christ's name we pray. Amen.
Good morning, everyone. It's been a couple of months since I've been up here. I'm not sure I remember how this goes. It's good to see everyone here today. Thank you, Ray, for a wonderful lesson, wherever you went. Are you back there? There you are. Good job, Ray. Beautiful lesson. Thank you so much, everyone, for being here. I know we have a few visitors. You're certainly welcome here. Some of you are from other congregations because they're not quite up and running yet. And we welcome you. Some of you are visiting from the neighborhood or with relatives, friends, so we welcome you. You're certainly welcome to join our services. The bulletin is in full force today. We do have a calendar in there and quite a few announcements. Please read it. It's chock full of things. There's a schedule going forward. There's a graduation ceremony. On the last page, the schedule going forward is one you're going to want to look at. I'm not going to repeat it all, but we have made the decision to start bringing things back to a more normal worship schedule. And 2 weeks from now, we should be just basically back on track with everything in force, Bible classes, et cetera. And so we're going to need you teachers to get involved, and you'll be contacted here shortly, I hope, from Jimmy, who will have the curriculum, and you may not have a lot of time to put things together, but I think we can make it happen, even though we may not have a lot of children at first. So let me make a few comments on maybe some of you that may be concerned about the fact that we're going back to normal. The decision was made to start now rather than later. 2 months, 3 months, 6 years from now, when will we go back to normal? Okay. My personal thoughts on the matter are that we live with viruses. We always have. We have the common cold. We have the flu. We have this now COVID, which is another virus. It's not as deadly and as bad as the government predicted and the media has hyped. That's my opinion. So if you're thinking that someday it's going to go away, I don't think that's going to happen. We're going to live with it, and we're going to have to decide whether we're going to be afraid of it or just going to be concerned about it and take precautions. So we would like for you to do your own social distancing at the comfort level that you would like. And as I look out among you, many of you are very sitting near each other. You're comfortable with that. I'm comfortable with that too. At some point, we're going to have enough people to where we're not really going to be separating the pews anymore. That's all going to happen organically. Okay? So if you are uncomfortable, though, and those that are listening, I want you to understand that the eldership totally supports you not coming if you don't feel like you're feeling safe. We have upped our website presence to where you can watch our services during the services, or even they'll be recorded and you can look at them afterwards. We've added a YouTube channel, we've added a Facebook connection there, and the live stream still exists. So it's all there for you. We support you in that. We want you to be comfortable and all of that. So if you have any concerns, of course, contact us and let us know if we can help you. The power for today is in the lobby, so pick that up. Terry and Carmen Hesselrode, as you know, will be moving to Jackson, Tennessee. So there is an Arizona book in the lobby. Please sign it. We're sad to lose them, but they're just moving because of retirement, and they want to be closer to their family, things like that. Janelle Hunt is going to be traveling. Actually, Karen and I and the kids, we're going to go see her today, but they'll be leaving on Tuesday to go to her daughter's in California. They have a very nice setup for her over there. She'll likely be there the entire summer. So that's Janelle Hunt. Janelle Hunt's daughter, Debbie, who lives in one of the Carolinas, north or south, I don't know. I think north anyway. She's recovering from a fall, hit her head or something, and so she's suffering a little there. And also this morning, placing membership are Greg and Kathy Risner. If you could please stand. We're so happy to have you with us. They've been here for a little while. Thank you. God bless you. And so they've chosen to worship with us and place membership here and work with us. We're excited about that. And I hope I don't miss anything here. I do have a few on the prayer list. Tina Beckman is having more tests. Thanks for prayers and cards. It's apparently leading to a major surgery. Then we have Frank Nichols is struggling with ulcers. Bud Travis, he was in urgent care with a deep cut on his hand. I understand he's back or went back to urgent care for something else. And so anyway, we need to keep the Travis family in our prayers because of their illnesses and different things that are happening there. John Lynch requests prayers for his granddaughter, Rachel, for strength, who is recovering in a rehab center. And Darlene Sire, who's in Montana, Steve's mother, is struggling with her health. Keep her in your prayers. Ruby Jones, the grandmother to Patrice and Henriette Hunt, passed away last week. And so our condolences are for the Hunt family there. And our condolences to Max and Geneva Bell for the sudden death of their daughter. And Marie Ismay requests prayers for her coworker who is diagnosed with stage 3 lung cancer. Amy Anderson is not feeling well. Concepcion Corpus, friend Sergio Parra, who has many health problems. And then Greg Wells' mother is suffering from some illnesses. I think she's gone through a surgery. She's in ICU. And so we're praying for the Wells family and how that all goes. That's a very stressful thing. So Greg Wells' mother's requesting no calls, okay? And Francis McCrory test for his skin cancer indicates he's clear of cancer. Very good. And he's here today. Very good. Very good. And Larry Thomas is home, and he's learning to walk again. So we need to pray for him and that situation. So did I miss anything? We're good? Okay. Thanks for being here. And remember now, upcoming Wednesday starts kind of a normal schedule on Wednesday, this coming Wednesday. All right? So if you would, bow with me in prayer. We thank you, God, for this life, even though this life has challenges and dangers. We pray, Father, that we would trust in you, that we would have faith, and that we would not live with fear, but that we would just live for you. We pray, Father, that we would help each other through crisis times such as this. We pray, Father, that we would trust in you through crisis times such as this. We pray for our nation that it recovers quickly from some of the restrictions and mandates that were imposed on our economic system. We pray, Father, that as we gather here and that we worship you, that you would put a hedge around us, that you would keep us safe, that you would protect us. But, Father, ultimately, we pray that we would be found serving you, and that we would be found forgiven, and that we would be found as children of yours. And Father, ultimately understanding that our eternal life is greater than this life. We pray that we would always serve you and live for you and teach others about you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.